Americans, it seems, are increasingly losing their faith in their government, their politics, and to a certain degree, losing faith in America itself and our ability to solve national problems. On the presidential level, we hear accusations that political leaders are traitors, un-American, that they're only looking after their own interests. Congress is even more disliked, unable to do big things with no ability to work together, and the most extreme voices eating up all the oxygen. We're even losing faith in our courts, now seen as entirely political by many and out of touch with the challenges facing regular Americans. Of course, we've recently lived through some of our lowest moments, a sign of what can happen when Americans lose faith in the system that has served them so well for the past 240-plus years. So when a bipartisan group of lawmakers, ranging from the very, very conservative to the very, very progressive, announced a billion-dollar plan to boost civics education in our schools, it generated some sorely needed hope. Until, that is, some other conservatives began to complain that civics education was some sort of liberal Trojan horse and would teach kids that America is a racist nation that should be hated. But that's not remotely close to what a new focus on civics would actually do and how it might actually help. So to learn more, I spoke with Christopher Riano. He's the president of the Center for Civic Education. Christopher, thanks for joining us. I should probably start by disclosing that I not only took and loved civics in high school, I actually had it for 4 years. And I'm firmly convinced I would not be doing what I do now had I not taken it, though I don't know how much of a selling point that's going to be to anyone else. So let me start on page one. What is civics education? What does it teach kids? And what doesn't it teach them?
You know, I've always looked at a civic and constitutional education as one of the most incredible educations we have possible. And why is that? Well, unlike almost any other form of education, a civic and constitutional education teaches us about the strengths of American democracy. It teaches us about some of the weaknesses in American democracy, but even more importantly, it often teaches us how to approach and strengthen those weaknesses and make a difference in our society. And civics is found in every classroom. It's found not just in a civics classroom, but in a math classroom, and it's found in every workplace. It's a very unique and very important area of study, and it's one of the reasons why I've found such a joy in spending so many years of my own work teaching and working in the civic and constitutional education space, because I think it's critical to our constitutional republic that we all understand both the fundamentals of where we come from, but also how to best address problems in our community, whether it's the local, the state, or at the national level.
Let's drill down on why civics education is needed now. What signs are you seeing that point to a lack of civics education? What headlines are out there that you see as that lack of education posing problems for our nation and our democracy?
You know, it's shocking because I think in so many ways, again, a civic and constitutional education is a lifelong journey. And while it's so important to celebrate that in the K through 12 space, I think we can look out at the American landscape at the moment and from a completely nonpartisan point of view, recognize that more work is needed to teach people about the best ways to approach their community and issues that may exist in their community. You know, one of my favorite conversations to have with my own students is that civics and the Constitution don't just start and end on voting day. It's elections are important. Jury service is important. But I always ask, what are you doing in your community the day after? And how are you building a civically responsible community that to live in? And I think you can see the headlines today show that there's a lack of knowledge of some of the very basic understandings of not just how there are three branches of government, but also how there are multiple layers of government and how those different layers and branches interact. I think it's a very important part of what we see in our American landscape and why it's important that folks understand at a basic level how some of that operates and how they can be engaged within that operation.
We also have a dialogue problem in our national life right now. How would enhanced civic education solve some of those problems that we see in that national and political dialogue today?
It's a brilliant question, and I couldn't agree more. I've always said if we can't have the difficult conversations that are important to have in any constitutional democracy, in a civics classroom, we can't have it at all. That's the place where we should be discussing things like the First Amendment or things like the 14th Amendment and how civil rights and social justice look in this country, both historically and today, but also into the future. It's the one place where we do need to make sure that we protect difficult conversations. It's exactly what you just said. And that dialogue is not always easy. You know, one of the things I've had a fortunate opportunity to do during the pandemic is to zoom around the country and zoom into different classrooms and talk with students at multiple different levels, from K through 12 to adult education. And the one thing that I always try to do myself is to make sure that I create a space where it's possible to have some of the more complex conversations that exist around both our written documents and our historical documents, but also our democratic norms and some of the things that aren't necessarily written on a page that we've followed for many hundreds of years that still need to be discussed and talked about when it comes to understanding how our system of government works and fundamentally how we relate to one another as fellow Americans.
Sounds like a class I would love to audit. We've made civics education a priority in this country before. Even something like the Schoolhouse Rock cartoons. If people don't remember, think of the cartoon I'm Just a Bill. And there were a lot of those cartoons. They came out in 1975, which is another period of distrust of government following the Nixon resignation. I wonder if you feel like we're in a similar spot when it comes to distrust of government that civics education can help solve.
You know, it's incredible. I come from government. I've worked in the federal government, I've worked in state government, and I've served in local government. And I think it's incredible to see the difference between what I've been able to see in many ways, that the good the government can do, and not sometimes the you know, problems the government can encounter. But at the same time, I love how you relate this back to things like Schoolhouse Rocks. I'm fortunate to now be leading an organization that's been around for over 50 years, and we've been helpful when it comes to putting a civic and constitutional education into both classrooms and outside of classrooms for over 50 years for millions of people. And I'm the first that says I celebrate that success. And I'm the first that says that we need to do more and we need to be able to do more. And both when it comes to the work that we get to do at the Center for Civic Education, but the work that happens within our sister organizations around the country, I think we all feel the same way. There's multiple different ways to approach ensuring that students and adults have a fundamental civic and constitutional base of knowledge. But at the same time, there's so much that needs to be done. And relating right back to what you said before, I think we can all agree the work is hardly done. There's so many different things that we should and can be doing. And it's one of the reasons that I think the civic space is such an exciting space to be a part of at this moment in our history.
There is a bipartisan effort in Congress right now to re-strengthen civics education, but because we're living in 2021, there's opposition to teaching it, mainly coming from conservative Republicans. But civics is not a partisan subject, as you've noted. And from my own experience, there were a lot of conservatives in my classes in the 1980s with Reagan and Bush in the White House. I take it that's true in your current experience as well. And also, wouldn't civics education provide tools that can actually help a conservative student become a better conservative, just as it would help a progressive student become a better progressive?
You know, I'm the first that is so proud of the fact that even last summer when my organization worked on a joint letter from Congress, it was co-sponsored and led by John Lewis and Kevin McCarthy. I am the first that thinks that a civic and constitutional education is a unifying force. It allows us to understand and better come to a bigger sense of our history as Americans. A true civic and constitutional education allows us to safely look at some of the weaknesses that do exist in our system. And it also allows us to find ways to be engaged to address those, as I mentioned before. This is a nonpartisan issue, and the support of civics should continue to be, as it has historically been, a nonpartisan issue.
It is a subject that I could literally talk about all day long, but I don't want to be accused of filibustering the show that I'm hosting tonight. So unfortunately, we're going to have to leave it there. Christopher Riano is the president of the Center for Civic Education. Christopher, thank you so much for your continuing efforts, as well as for taking a few minutes to spend with us.
Oh, thank you for having me.